You're watching Economics Amplified, the latest thinking on the biggest issues from UChicago's Becker Friedman Institute.
Welcome to everybody here. You know, this is an event sponsored by the Institute, the BFI Institute, as we call it. So let me, before I introduce our distinguished speaker, let me make a few comments. Today is December 10th. Now, why is that so important? It was the day that people received the Nobel Prizes in Sweden, which they already have done a few hours ago. And two of the people who did receive it was Lars Hansen, who's research director of the BFI, and Gene Fama, of course, a longtime distinguished professor at Booth School and, you know, colleague of many of us here. So that just happened a few hours ago. And let me say, having gone through this process 21 years ago, it's an event you never forget. So I'm sure they will never forget. Now, let me tell you a little bit about our institute. Many of you know about it. We try to do cutting-edge research or support cutting-edge research on topics that have public policy relevance. And that combination, I think, is important to recognize. So we're not a think tank, in a sense, dealing solely with policy issues and trying to, you know, retail maybe good research done by others and then promote it. That's an important role, but we don't do that. We follow the tradition of the great economists who've gone through Chicago, Milton Friedman, George Stigler, Ted Schultz, Mert Miller, and I can go on and on with distinguished economists who really did basic research, and it turned out their work had enormous influence on the world. So that's what we're trying to do. And currently we're working on topics and supporting research on topics as varied as, you know, interconnection between financial markets and the macroeconomy, one of Lars's strong interests. The role of inequality and education of the human capital investments and intergenerational mobility. The president recently said, for example, that mobility has declined in the United States. There's no evidence that has happened, by the way. But it's an important topic, and we're trying to work on that topic. And I hope to see us starting some work on regulation, which has grown enormously, and the U.S. is really, if you look at the regulatory standing of the U.S. relative to other countries, we've continued to fall in that standing in terms of more and more regulation. Right. So some of you are already connected with the BFI in various ways, and I hope more of you can get involved, because I think what is being done at the Institute is very exciting. Now, the speaker today, distinguished economist Luigi Zingales, received his BA at Bocconi University, the most distinguished university, at least for economics, by far, in Italy. That's right, Luigi. Right? I've always thought so. His PhD at MIT, a pretty good university as well. And he came to Chicago shortly after getting his PhD, and he's remained here more or less with visiting at other places since that time. His research covers various issues of corporate finance, corporate governance, interest group analysis, political economy, the role of trust in an economy, general financial behavior, and many others. So he has very broad interests, broader than most economists. He's been recognized for many awards and so on, both in Europe and the United States. But I particularly want to mention that I think he's twice received the Leo Melamed Prize for work in financial economics. And since Leo is here, I mean, it's particularly appropriate that I mention that today, a very distinguished award. So without further ado, Luigi, why don't you tell us what's going on?
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure. Thanks for the introduction, Gary. Basically, the real economists are either in Sweden or have received the Nobel Prize. Here you have the leftovers. So I'm in the leftovers group. What I will try to describe to you today is basically why the euro created so many troubles a couple of years ago, and what I think the situation will be in the future. Because if you remember, most Americans don't pay attention to what happens in Europe except when it's a disaster. So 2 years ago, everybody was on the brink of their chair, say, oh, what's happening? And is the euro gonna going to collapse? And will this create another recession in the United States? And so on and so forth. And now everything seems quiet. In fact, if you read the newspapers, you see that some countries are actually revolting in order to join Europe. And this is the Ukraine that they said, we want in. And said, wait a minute, there is this club in which some people want to get out, some people want to get in. So what's happening there? So, and why from 2 years ago, when there was such a big sort of a disaster, now everything is quiet, and what can we expect moving forward? So let me start from the very basic. Why sort of the euro was created to begin with, and what were sort of the mistakes when it was created, how they emerge over the years. So first of all, you have to realize that the euro has been considered as a necessary step toward the unification of Europe. So it's hard to think about the euro as separate as the European unification process. And that process started from the ashes of World War II, in which basically a generation, after seeing the disaster they created, they said, never again. And so they started by sort of creating some organization to trade on the steel and coal, etc. And then finally, in 1957, the six countries reached sort of an agreement for a freer trade, a European sort of free trade area. And that European free trade area from six countries enlarged successively, and now we are at 27, 28, I lost count because they keep adding, and sort of was quite a success from the point of view of generating integration, economic growth, and until recently, a much better understanding and, if you want, mutual recognition among the European countries. One of the institution that I like the most of the European Union is a program called Erasmus, which is a fellowship for younger college students to go and spend a semester in another European country. And so the younger generation of Europeans feel European first and then sort of a citizen. This is very, very different than my generation or the generation of my parents, that they strongly felt Italian, German, French before they felt anything else. So in that sense, this is a fantastic realization that unfortunately, this is my claim for tonight, unfortunately, instead of being enhanced, has been delayed or even sort of set back by the creation of the euro. So first of all, let's think about why having a common currency matter and what economic theory suggests should be the set of countries that share a common currency. So there are a number of reasons why a currency is important, but I want to sort of point out mainly to three. The first one is you want to basically maintain a stable level of prices, so that exchange can take place in an orderly manner, investment, savings, etc. But most importantly, you want to also maintain an exchange rate vis-a-vis sort of the rest of the world. It's an exchange rate that adjusts when a shock occurs. So in Australia, just to give you an example, I was in Australia last summer, and a truck driver make 140,000 Australian dollars that are not too far from US dollar. So a huge salary. Why? Because there was a huge boom in Australia in the last 15 years, driven by the China development and demand of commodities from China. So clearly all the prices went up. Now imagine that China has a slowdown. It's very hard for that truck driver to still be making $140,000. And if this happens all of a sudden, it's not that easy to actually cut down that wage and readjust. And so it's much easier to keep sort of the salary constant, but then drop the Australian dollar vis-a-vis all the other currency so that Australian remains competitive even after the end of the boom in commodity boom driven by China. And the same is true of what happened in England, in the United Kingdom, with the financial crisis. The financial sector of the UK became less important. And as a result, overall, the UK economy became less productive. And so it was very useful to readjust the exchange rate. And that's exactly what they did. Now, of course, I sort of compare devaluation as sort of a drug. That drugs are extremely useful when you're sick, but if you use them on a constant basis, it's not good. And they make you addicted. And that's what many countries, including my country of origin, Italy, did for many years, during the 70s and the 80s. Italy had continuous devaluation that were sort of fueling a growth in the manufacturing economy, because every devaluation, wages were fixed, and all of a sudden, fixing local currency, so in lira terms, every time the lira was devalued vis-a-vis sort of the Deutschmark, Italy became cheaper, and so was much better able to export and so on and so forth. But if you do that over and over and over again, you have two consequences. First of all, people will require a premium to invest in your own currency because they don't trust that you don't devalue. Number two, even the entrepreneurs, and this is my view of Italy, the entrepreneurs become lazy, because why do you have to invest in technology and make your product better and more competitive if you know that every, let's say, third year, you have a devaluation that reduces your cost every of 20 or 30%. In fact, your competitive advantage is in investing in products that are very elastic vis-a-vis price. Why? Because when you have a reduction in production cost, you can slash prices and increase demand dramatically, so that will increase profits. On the other hand, if you specialize in products that are very inelastic with respect to price, that are generally more advanced products, a devaluation is not a gigantic advantage. So in part, the reason why Italy specializes in producing sort of Fiat rather than producing BMW or Mercedes is because Fiats are very elastic to prices. So every time there was a devaluation, you could sell more Fiat. And sort of BMW and Mercedes, much less so. Now, of course, Italy produced also Ferrari, and those are not very elastic to price, but that's a niche production, and it's not the main production. But anyway, so this is the first function of having your own independent monetary policy, is that allows to adjust to shocks in a more effective way. However, if you overdo it, then becomes a problem, and that's the desire to basically tie your hands and prevent this happening in the future. The other sort of main things why having an independent monetary policy is useful is that if you have a bank panic, then you can deal with that bank panic by printing more money. So if all of a sudden people, like in the Great Depression, all of a sudden people have feel unsafe and want to increase the amount of liquidity they have in their under the mattress for whatever reason, whether it's a rational or irrational reason doesn't really matter, but they want to hold more liquidity under their mattress. If you can print more of it and give it to them, basically nothing happens. And then as they calm down, you reabsorb this and you move on. But if you cannot print that, then you have a problem. So during the Great Depression, the United States were in a gold standard sort of situation. They couldn't increase all of a sudden the supply of money, and the result was pretty disastrous. In many other situations, the people could, and the problem was fixed. And in general, having an independent monetary authority is useful when you have a banking crisis, because you can deal with that banking crisis very effectively rather than leaving sort of all the banks to fail with the consequences this has. And unfortunately or fortunately, when the euro was created around sort of was started in the late 80s and then was sort of finalized in the late 90s, Europe did not have a banking crisis for a long, long time. On the other hand, Europe had a very high level of inflation. And so many countries, including Italy and including France, including Spain, including Portugal, they said, oh, we want to basically get a currency that is not that easy to inflate. And so we want to basically adopt the Deutschmark. However, we don't really want just to adopt the Deutschmark. We would like to have some saying so that the Deutschmark is run not just in the interest of the Germans, but in the interest of Europe at large. Because, you know, there are countries like Panama, for example, is on the dollar. They have given up their individual currency because they consider themselves not capable of running a central bank in a very effective way. And so they delegate this authority to the United States, but they have no seat at the Federal Reserve board meeting, so they don't have any influence on what the monetary decisions of the United States are. Now, if you're Panama, you're probably too small to matter anyway, so it's not a big deal. But in Europe, that was a big issue. So people wanted to have an institution that was more common. And so the Germans were very reluctant in giving away their sort of currency, also because, to be honest, they had the best track record in terms of keeping low inflation over the years. And so they said, we are going to give up our beloved Deutschmark in exchange for a number of conditions. Number one, the central bank should be in Frankfurt. Surprise, surprise, because that's where also the German central bank was. Number two, we should copy exactly all the rules that apply to the German central bank. And we should try to have sort of central bankers that, if they're not exactly Germans, at least they look like Germans. And, you know, initially they started with a Dutch, pretty close. Then they had a French that was not exactly as good, but still sort of in the same tradition. Then they ended up picking an Italian. Now, he's the most German of all the Italians that you can meet. In every respect, and it says, unlike most Italians and unlike myself, he doesn't gesticulate, he's not sort of overly excited, he's very sort of low-key. But anyway, and to this day, they are resenting this decision, and there is, and I will come to that later, there is a huge political sort of debate about this. But so, when this unification was done mostly for political reasons, because this was on the follow-up of the fall of the Berlin Wall and of German unification. Germany was big enough even before unification. After unification, became by far the largest country in Europe, and the rest of the European countries, in particularly France, were very afraid of Germany becoming the dominant country. And so France, in that case was Mitterrand, decided we are going to allow the sort of German unification, as if they could block it, but they said, we're going to allow the German unification in exchange for a common currency. And so economists, mostly in America, but even in Europe, said, wait a minute, in order to have a common currency, you have to have some conditions. What are these conditions? Actually, these conditions were worked out by Mandel, who used to be faculty member at Chicago and is a Nobel Prize winner. Mandel said, look, you need to have three conditions. Number one, the area should not be subject to asymmetric shocks. What does it mean? That generally, when you have an independent monetary authority, you can fine-tune your monetary policy and your exchange rate to the needs of that area. But if you have areas that are very different in terms of economic needs, and one is hit and the other is not hit, how do you fit a monetary policy for all of them? You cannot. Now, this is not the only condition, because the United States, let's face it, they're not an optimal currency area from that point of view. Texas is an oil country, and Massachusetts is a biotech country. So when oil prices go up, you have a boom in Texas, and you know, if biotech does not go up at the same time, you might have a bust in Massachusetts. And vice versa, when you have a bust in the oil sector and you have a boom in biotech. So in the mid 80s, when there was an oil bust, Massachusetts was booming. In the late 80s, beginning of the 90s, there was a Massachusetts bust, and on the other hand, Texas was booming, and you keep going back and forth. So how do the United States deal with that? Two very simple ways. Number one, labor mobility. I just met a lady, she was from Texas, and now she lives in Chicago. I think that's normal, and people don't make a big deal out of it. And it says, you move from Texas to Chicago or to Massachusetts, not only you speak the same language, more or less, a bit of accent, but what a big deal. But everything is the same except the weather. You go to the same Starbucks, go to the same restaurants, you have the same, you don't really have any adjustment you can think of. Now, for a Spanish to move to Frankfurt, it's much more difficult. And it says, I was shocked that when I went and visited the European Central Bank, at the cafeteria of the European Central Bank, the menu was only in German. Okay, this is to give you a sense of how sort of Catholic and broad-minded they are. And sort of the food is different, the habits are different. You feel discriminated because, oh, if you're an Italian, you must be a Latin lover, or sort of you're lazy, or well, you name it. So all the stereotypes are present and are very important. The second point, which we tend to forget in the United States, but is quite important, is there is quite a bit of fiscal redistribution within the United States. So last time I checked, Louisiana was getting 13% of their income from fiscal transfer from the rest of the United States. No country in Europe get more than 2%. So there is a massive difference of fiscal redistribution. And so the big problem is when sort of Portugal or Greece get a shock, how do they adjust? They've given up the exchange rate sort of adjustment way, and they've not received any compensating factor. So the only way for them is to basically either migrate with all the problems that this generates, or go through a serious depression in order to readjust the internal prices. And you know, we might discuss how prices are flexible, sort of labor prices, but there are some prices that are very inflexible. Those are called mortgages. So if you are a Spanish guy, you borrow in order to buy your house. Now, all of a sudden, sort of, there is a crisis in Spain. Not only your house has lost value, and by the way, in Spain, you cannot do like the United States, walk away and get free. No, no, no. They chase after you for generations to come. So you're basically a slave of the bank until you pay down your debt. And sort of, all of a sudden, suppose that all the prices were to cut in half to make Spain more competitive, your mortgage will still stay fixed in nominal term. So you can't pay it. So readjustment is extremely difficult if you don't have an exchange rate. Now, this is not rocket science, in many sense, was rocket science when it was developed, but by the time the euro was created, this was very clear to everybody. And, you know, from Krugman to Martin Feldstein, so the political spectrum, all of the Americans commentator would say, you are crazy to do this. And the European were saying, so what? We're going to sort of start, and then we're going to fix along the process. And then they will say, you know, even the United States of America were not started the way they are. They evolve as a union. And by the way, you had a pretty bloody civil war in the between. Not that we didn't have a lot of civil wars in Europe. But anyway, so you see the point. And the idea, and this is to some extent is the part I'm most resentful to that generation, is they started with the idea that you basically put the political system with the shoulders against the wall, and eventually they're going to deliver the right answer. So this was not an idea that we should slowly, by consensus, move in that direction. This was the idea of a small political elite that say, we have the right idea. And by the way, I agree with the idea. I think that European unification is a fantastic idea. But they said, we have the right idea, and we're going to impose on those damn people who don't know any better, and we're going to impose it with a bunch of tricks by basically putting the cart ahead of the horses. And by the time the cart is ahead of the horses, either you move the horses or you don't move. And the assumption was that in those situations, you will move the horses and everything will be fine, because the history of Europe was a history in which so the move forwards were done at a time of crisis. And so they hope that this will continue. And to be honest, there was a dramatic benefit of unification, at least for some countries, my own in particular. So I want to show, I have only two slides. I want to show the first slide because I think is fascinating. This is the spread of government bonds with vis-a-vis sort of the German Bund before and after the introduction of the euro and at the time of the recent crisis. So you see the euro was introduced here. And so in the expectation that the euro would be created, interest rate converged. And all of a sudden, risk kind of disappeared. And then risk resurfaced in 2010 all of a sudden. So why this was the case, why it happened, and why it was so extreme? Because I remember, I'm old enough to remember the discussion about the convergence of the rates and the question of what should be the Italian spread vis-a-vis the German bonds. And nobody knew that when you are starting in 96, there was a huge spread. If we join the euro, at what rate will it converge? And you know, a natural thing to do, and this is what a lot of people did, is to look at the US states and say, it's not like Illinois and Massachusetts borrow the same rate. They have a different rate, not gigantically different, but different rates, reflecting the intrinsic riskiness of these countries. And in Europe, this was even more extreme. There was basically no spread. And looking backward, you say, how is this possible? And says, who is the person in the right frame of mind that think that borrowing from Greece or Italy is the same as borrowing from Germany in terms of risk? So was the market wrong during that time? And the answer is, of course, not. The market was not wrong, was dragged. And by who was dragged? By sort of the combination of the European policy and the banking regulatory policy. So there used to be a crazy rule that is still in place, but this crazy rule says that if you are a bank, you know, banks have some capital requirements that is a function of the riskiness of the assets they hold. And the requirement was that if you hold debt of your own sovereign, the capital requirement was zero. Why? There's no logical justification. The only justification is that governments make rules, and so the rules are all in the favor of the government. So individual governments said, if you are, you have your own sort of, if your banks own your own sort of debt, that debt is considered safe. So if you are Argentina, Argentinian bank, and you hold an Argentinian debt, you need to hold zero capital because that's a safe debt. Now, if this was not crazy enough, this rule was in place, but they said, okay, now that you are in Europe, every sovereign is the same. So all of a sudden, you have zero capital requirement equally for Greek debt and German debt. Now, if you sort of hold Greek debt and this Greek debt holds like as a slightly higher yield, as a bank, you are very tempted to buy it because you have to put the same capital as to buy German debt, i.e. zero, but you have a higher yield. So that creates a huge opportunity, and all the banks started to do it, encouraged by ECB governors who until very recently, says Trichet stepped down while saying, no country in Europe will be let fail. And this is clearly false. And now they call, you know, with a different name, is like sex for Bill Clinton, is with a different name, is a different things. And the same is sort of default for Greece. They did default, but they call it sort of a restructuring, and by that name, so you can save the face of the ECB. But de facto, the underlying assumption for all the European countries was that you will not have a default. And so if you don't have a default and everybody's treated the same, they better yield the same rate. And that's the reason why the rates went dramatically down. And this created a gigantic opportunity for Italy because, you know, Italy had a very high interest rates expecting a default of Italy. Now, Italy joined the euro. And by the way, I remember that Merton Miller very sort of presciently said, when Italy joined the euro, they need to renegotiate all their debt and all their retirement benefits. Because they made promises in lira that are worth as much as you can imagine, and they are transforming all of a sudden those promises in lira in promises in Deutschmark. And that's not sustainable. And you know, what is not sustainable eventually will not be sustained. Takes a while, but eventually that's the case. So, but at the time there was this huge euphoria and the interest rate went down because Italy had a very large debt to GDP. That the savings generated by joining the euro was so substantial that had they simply saved that money and paid down the debt by that money, so I'm not saying they should have cut down any expenses, simply not spend more, today they would have a debt to GDP of 80%. So better than Germany and the same level as the United States, depending if you do gross or net, but roughly the same level as the United States. Unfortunately, we're down to 130. Up to 130, whatever. So the why is because I think that the euro creation was a bit of the result of hubris. That you think that you can change a country, the policy of a country, or everything just by tying their hands in a certain way. So Italy at a very high rate because people expect high inflation. They expect high inflation because there was a history of high inflation, a history of bad government, and history of bad large deficit. So they just imagine that if you join the euro and you cannot inflate, that risk will disappear. That risk did not disappear. Greece suffers in a, to some extent, more dangerous way, which is the risk of default. Because you can't change sort of the nature of a country just by fiat. I think the United States learned that by going to Iraq. But Europe learned that at their own expenses. And the result is that, you see, after a number of years, the risk started to resurface because there was seriously a risk of default. And in front of that risk of default, they realized, wait a minute, we don't have any of the mechanisms to redistribute the shock in some way. And what are these mechanisms? At the very minimum, a joint sort of a guarantee of deposits so that in the moment in which you see that Greece is in difficulties, Greek people start to take their money and put it in German banks. So that's a run on sort of on German banks, on Greek banks at the expense of two German banks at the expense of Greek banks, and the same in Spain and so on and so forth. So this was a pretty serious drag. Second, this country needs a dramatic restructuring, and this restructuring generally is facilitated in the United States by having some common unemployment insurance. So when Texas went through a recession, Massachusetts were helping paying for their insurers. And when Massachusetts had a recession, the Texas taxes were helping pay for the Massachusetts unemployment insurance. Here, there is no redistribution whatsoever. Not only that, they don't even want the redistribution because, of course, they found a reason that the Greeks and the Italians are lazy. And that's the reason why they don't deserve to be paid with the taxpayers of the Germans. Now, Italians and Greeks have a lot of defects. I'm the first one to recognize that. But actually, the lazy claim doesn't hold, because if you look at the number of hours worked, it's much higher in Greece and Italy than in Germany. Why? Because they have to spend half of the day to fight against an inefficient government, and the remaining half of the day they can produce. In Germany, they only spend a quarter of the day fighting against the inefficient government, so they are a quarter of a day ahead. And so they are more productive and they can work less, which is a combination is pretty good. But so now we are in the middle of the road, in a situation in which it's very difficult to go backward, but there is not political will to move forward. Why? Because, in a sense, we created Europe before creating the Europeans. Remember, I started saying one of the great creations of Europe was the fellowship program that allows sort of people to travel around and started to feel like fellow European citizens. You need like 50 years of that before you start treating all the same. Because here, when Louisiana is in trouble, nobody starts saying in Louisiana they are lazy and we don't want to pay the unemployment insurance because in Louisiana are lazy. You consider them fellow American. And so we need to be in a situation in which you want to do that redistribution in order to have a sort of a monetary union. And that is called, you have to have a fiscal union at the same time as you have a monetary union. When you don't have a fiscal union, nor you want to do a fiscal union, you cannot do a monetary union. And now, in addition to that, and this is a talk for another day, but in addition to that, sort of my own country, Italy, but I think Spain is pretty similar, went through a major crisis in terms of productivity. So I want to show you that picture because I don't believe this is caused by the euro. In fact, I'm working on a paper that demonstrates exactly the opposite. However, this is remarkably coincidental with the introduction of the euro. This is the productivity per hour work. The black sort of line is the United States. Europe is in the middle, and the dashed line is Italy. And you see that up to 1995, Europe, Italy, and the United States were moving up at the same pace. And then something happened in the mid-90s that made the United States accelerate, Europe slow down, and Italy to stop. So for the last basically almost 20 years, productivity per hour work is not going up. And you know, if you have a high debt to GDP, the only way to sustain it is to have improvement in productivity. Because if you don't have growth, and growth can come from improvement in productivity or increasing population. Now, we don't have children, so we're not growing that. We're not willing to import massively other people, because that's the other solution. But, you know, that's not easy. So the only way out is productivity improvement. And we had zero for the last 20 years. So the idea that Italy sooner or later will not be able to pay its debt is a reality. And so the question is, how can we cope with that in Europe? And for a little while, I had an idea that I thought was a pretty brilliant idea how to fix the problem. Because unilaterally exit from the euro is a bloodbath, especially for an advanced economy like Italy. Why? Because if you unilaterally get out, you can relabel your liabilities in whatever currency you want, but companies that issue bonds in Luxembourg or in London, like most bonds in Europe are, cannot redenominate their liabilities. So if you are an Italian company, like Fiat, for example, with bonds in euro, Italy gets out of the euro, the bonds remain in euro, and the revenues start to be in liras. That's not a very good sort of combination. And we have an experience of what happened in that situation. It's called Argentina. In Argentina, they did exactly that. They basically had liabilities in dollars. Initially, there was a perfect peg, one-to-one, and then they broke the peg. And all of a sudden, companies that were in Argentina found themselves with liabilities that were three times what it used to be. And I have an example of a company called Telecom Argentina. They were investing $1 billion a year. They went down to $50 million for 3 years until they renegotiated all their debt. So imagine this multiplied by the number of companies. That's a disaster. However, there might be a way out, which is called sort of for some countries to get out of the euro, what I call from the north. So if you create a more valuable currency, it's much easier to keep people out than you to prevent people from escaping. So if Germany were to create a northern euro and one day converts its euro one-to-one in northern Europe, but they decide what assets are converted in northern Europe. So they say, if you are a German, you deposit in Germany, I convert your euro. But if you're an Italian deposit in Germany, I don't convert your stuff. And I think that's doable. And if you separate the euro into two, a northern European and a southern European, this is basically along the line of the crisis. Ireland is the exception, but I think it's the exception that proves the rule, because Ireland is doing pretty well now and probably sort of joining the northern European country as part of the country. So it's basically you have what is called in jargon Club Med, southern Europe, and then you have northern Europe, and you have a division along those lines. I think that that would be fairly feasible, because southern Europe will readjust immediately. The economy will restart growing, so they could pay their debt and so on and so forth. Now, why I was so optimistic and now I think this is not feasible? The big problem is called France. Because you don't know where France is. Is it in Northern Europe or Southern Europe? And if you ask the French, they would say, of course, in Northern Europe, because they're very proud. But if you look at the economy, you say they belong to Southern Europe. And so they cannot afford to be with a Northern European, but they cannot afford economically, they cannot afford politically to be with Southern Europe. And Germany cannot afford to start a Northern European sort of group without France. Why? It looks a bit too much like the Fourth Reich. And, you know, you can see easily the Germans saying, we and the French are moving forward, creating the avant-garde of the European unification by doing fiscal union with a stronger currency. That could be solved politically. You can now see sort of the Germans with what? With sort of the Austrian, the Dutch, and the Finn creating that Northern Europe? It's not going to work, okay? So I think that this is a dramatic situation from which it's very difficult to know how you get out. And what has happened in the meantime is the market was dragged. Again, in that graph, I didn't show you how the sort of the spread has gone down. And the spread has gone down, why? Because Mario Draghi, governor of the ECB, said that the ECB will do whatever it takes to save the euro. And you know, if you are a speculator, you are very careful not to pick a fight with somebody who can print money, because you're going to lose. And so even if you think that the euro is not sustainable, eventually this is going to happen, but you don't want to be the first one to start a fight and be destroyed by sort of a Mario Draghi printing more money. And so everybody is careful. And so today rates are relatively quiet because the Draghi bluff so far, or the Draghi bazooka, is credible. The moment you start to doubt that he can actually use that bazooka, Europe is gone, or at least the European integration, as we know, is gone before we know. And so what is the future, at least in my view? The future is not looking good either way. In a sense, you can see with some probability, a crisis and a breakup that would be extremely painful for everybody. You can see on the other end, a muddling through, which in my view will lead to a slow desertification of Southern Europe. There is a very useful and very sad analogy between Italian unification and European unification. For those of you who are not very conversant in Italian history, Italy became a unified country 153 years ago, 52, in 1861, as a result of some smart people who put together a bunch of states that felt very little sort of together at the time, okay? And the idea was, Italy is a beautiful ideal, and we, small elite, are gonna lead the masses into this major social engineering that will bring some magnificent results. And we got the unification, but you got unification basically with a northern currency, with a northern regulation, with the northern rules imposed overnight to the south. And in 1861, Naples and Palermo were among the most prosperous capital in Europe. The first railway in Italy was done in Naples. In the next 30 or 40 years, all the industry disappeared, and the brightest move to the north, if not to America, the south became a problem for Italy. We are doing exactly the same in Europe. You have a European unification, which is done with the northern rules, the northern currency, and sort of the northern law, by and large, imposed on the rest of Europe. And the southern European countries who cannot adapt, they are basically left behind. And you see a migration of people more and more to the north and outside. The number of people with a degree that left Italy doubled in 10 years. Italy is in the worst trade of all. We export high human capital people, we import low human capital people. The fact that the productivity is not rising has something to do with it. And how long can you be in that trade before you become just sort of a glorified Disneyland? And I think that that's the risk of much of Southern Europe. The only way, possible way ahead is really at this point to do some significant step toward a European unification. But, you know, this is a situation where it's very difficult to blame either side. If you are German, you're saying, why do I need to pay for Italians' past mistakes? And they're absolutely right, especially because, you know, in 2011, at the beginning of this crisis, the European Central Bank said, we're going to intervene if you Italian government promises to do a certain number of things. So they signed this promise. 2 days later, Berlusconi went back to Italy, and the ECB started to buy the Italian bond. Berlusconi reneged on his promises. So if you're German, say, why should we pay money to a country that does not hold up their promises? And how can you blame them? On the other hand, the Italians are saying, sort of, why should we suffer blood and tears if there is no distinct future? This is not a union. This is a domination. And they feel like an invasion, like the Greek did. And so the result is that the euro that was created to make further steps in the European integration is becoming now the opposite, is becoming an obstacle. The Greeks are calling the Germans Nazi. 10 years ago, they didn't. And the thing we're not realizing is this enlightened small elite that ran the European integration process don't realize that the masses are getting more and more against the Europe in the worst ways. So people have not noticed, but, you know, the last election in Greece, 45% of the people voted either for a true communist party, and we're not talking about sort of Obama, we're talking about truly communist. People said that they're still sort of with a hammer and sickle, or a neo-Nazi party, okay? 45% divided among these two guys. In Italy, 25% of the votes was given to a party, anti-European party, run by a professional comedian. I stress professional because the other politicians are just comedian, and this one is a professional comedian. Now the latest poll say that in France, the largest party is run by Marie Le Pen. It's an anti European party, worse than that, is a racist party. And in England, even if they're not in the euro, the sort of right-wing extremists are gaining momentum. And the real moment would be this year or this coming year, European election, because, you know, the European Parliament doesn't count for anything. So why people go to vote? To protest. So this is the cheapest way to protest without consequences you can have. And I think that the European Parliament in 2014 would be full of anti-European. And I think that the risk of a dramatic breakup of Europe or a rising anti-European sentiment is really among us. And we need to act before it's too late. Unfortunately, I don't see anybody with the vision and the wisdom to do so. Thank you.